Ya Rabbana Al-Fatih, Qayyim Kama Yanbaghi Li Jalali Wajhik Wa Azim Sultanik, Subhanaka La Nasifa Lana Illa Alayka Kama Athnayta Ala Nafsik, Falak Alhamdu Hatta Tarda, Walak Alhamdu Idha Radita, Walak Alhamdu Ba'da Al-Ridha. Allahumma salli wa sallim ala Sayyidina Muhammad fil awwalin, wa salli wa sallim ala Sayyidina Muhammad fil akhirin, wa salli wa sallim ala Sayyidina Muhammad fi kulli waqtin wa heen, wa salli wa sallim ala Sayyidina Muhammad fil madal ala ila yawm al-deen, wa salli wa sallim ala Sayyidina Muhammad hatta yatabidh al-arba wa man alayha wa anta khayr al-warithin. Alhamdulillah. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessings of those who are continual and perpetual inside of His praise, Subhanah. And the conversation of our existence with the Lord, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, is a conversation of praise. And that is why the greatest being that Allah, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, ever crafted was the being of praise. He was the greatest praise as a subject, and He was greatest praise as an object, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And those who are the most proximate to Him are the most proximate to Allah Ta'ala. And those who are the most proximate to Him are those who are the greatest and the most profound and the most perpetual and continual inside of the praise of the Lord Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Yawm al-Qiyamah, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has a supreme standard, and his standard is known as the standard of praise, Liwa al-Hamd. And those who are proximate to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, likewise, they have standards that draw from his standard. He informed us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةُ وَلِيَقُومُ الْحَمَّادُونَ, that those people who have taken to praise, whose praise is continual and perpetual, let them arise. And thereby the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said that thereby arise the Hamadun, and they are given standards, flags. And thereby they are told to enter into paradise, bila sabaqati adab, without no prior punishment, wala hisab, or no prior reckoning, wala fitna, or no prior tribulation, wali yaqoom al-hammadun. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum wardahum, they wanted to enter inside of the sphere of the hammadun. And so they asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, asifhum lana ya Rasulullah, describe them for us, O Messenger of Allah. And the Prophet ﷺ described them, he said, الَّذِينَ يَحْمِدُونَ اللَّهَ عَلَى كُلِّهَا. These are people who praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in every state and in every condition and every time. They're the Hammadun. The Hammadun are those who follow closely the footsteps of Muhammad. He is the supreme Hammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His name is Muhammad, the object of intense praise. His name is Ahmed, the subject of praise. Nobody ever has praised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like the Prophet who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a spirit, the supreme spirit. The spirit that is said that is the size of the cosmos. And in every aspect of that spirit, he praised God. He praised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Dhaka huwa Muhammad. That's Muhammad. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a supreme intellect, a vast intellect. Like the great Imam of the Yemen, Wahb ibn Munabbih, rahimahullah ta'ala, Imam of the Tabi'een, student of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum wardahum, who said that the collective intellect of man, besides the intellect of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Muhammad, is like one grain of sand in comparison to all of the grains of sand upon all of the beaches upon the place, the face of planet Earth. That's Muhammad. And with that intellect, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he praised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with every grain of sand of that vast and bewildering intellect, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Likewise with the form that Allah ta'ala gave him, a perfect form. Yani as Sayyidina Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha wardaha, ka'annaka khuliqta kama tasha'u. It's as if you were created as you willed, as you desired. In terms of form, body, beautiful, to say the end. Ibn Abi Hala radiallahu ta'ala anhu, what Allah said about the form of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with that form, he praised the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not static, he's not static of spirit, he's not static of mind, and he's not static of form. He's dynamic sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and in the dynamism of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was what praise for the Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala.
من عرف نفسه عرف ربه. The one who knows himself knows his Lord. So the journey of life is about knowledge of self. It's about coming into knowledge of self. For the reason that we become those who know Allah. Those who know God, that's the very reason we were created. وَمَا خَلَقَتُوا الْجِنَّةِ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونِي. I never created jinkind or mankind إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونِي. Save that they should know me. The great Imam of the Companions, Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said, "Hey, يَعْرِفُونَنِي," meaning to know me. And the only way we know God is by knowledge of self. But the only way we know the self is by knowledge of the one who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to the self, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yeah, that Allah ta'ala sent the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ila al-nas kaffa, unto all humanity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wa ma arsalnaka illa rahmatan lil alameen, that we both sent you as a mercy to the entire alameen, the entire world. So the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he sent to the world of the angels. In its vastness, the world of the angels. Yet there is not a space, and there is not anti-space in the universe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, say that the angel caught in feet, say that the angel inside of that space and that anti-space. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, there's not a space in the universe. He said, أطط السماء, that the entire heavens groans, the entire heavens moans, أطط السماء. وَكَانَ أَحَقَّ لَهَا تَعِقْ, and it's only right that it groans, the entire heavens. The Prophet ﷺ says, there is not a space of four fingers in the heavens, إِلَّا فِيهِ مَلَكٌ سَاجِدٌ, said that in it is an angel prostrate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the entire cosmos of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, there's not a leaf that falls from a tree, say that it's an angel that brings it down to earth. There's not a drop of rain that falls from the heavens, say that it's an angel that brings it down to earth. Whether you gaze into the highest echelon of the universe, beyond the sitra, at the throne of God, as Allah Ta'ala says at the end of Surah Al-Zumar, watara, watara, these are the eyes of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, watara, and you will see, hafina min hawl al-arsh, you will see angels that say come ambulate the throne of God. It's the furthest point of the vast universe that Allah Ta'ala created. We believe now, don't we? We believe, those who follow modern science, who take modern science as a God, that the universe has a boundaries. It has an end. The universe has an end. And that end, in terms of our eschatology, is Arshallah, is the throne of God. And at that throne are angels. In fact, there are many from Ahlul Islam who believe the throne itself is an angel. So whether you're at what they call the Arsh, the first echelons, or the Farsh, the bottommost abyss of the universe, angels, Malak. And all of those angels, they are recipients of the divine message that was brought with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's your first statement, Rabbul Alameen. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةَ الْعَالَمِينَ. The Alameen are angels. The Alameen are all a jinn, the sprite, the vastness of the world of the jinn. فَقَلَيْن, who inhabit earth, just like we inhabit earth. And likewise, Rasulullah Azam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent to the ins, sent to humanity. Al-Aswad wal-Ahmad, as he would say, the red and the black. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would say, it's not like the previous prophets who were just sent to their people. كَانِ نَبِيٌ يُبْعَدُ إِلَىٰ قَوْمِ خَاصٌ. Prophets would only send to their people. وَلَكِنِّي بُعِثُ إِلَىٰ النَّاسِ عَامٌ. But I was sent to all people. All people. From the first of them to the last of them. From the red of them to the black of them to the yellow of them to the white of them. From those who are proximate to the island of the Arabs and those who are the most distant from the island of the Arabs. From those who live in the age of the Prophet and those who live before or beyond the age of the Prophet Muhammad, he was sent to them. But the peculiarity of the Prophets themselves, the suitability of the Prophets themselves, they are sent bilughati qawmihim. They are sent in the language of their people. And so what language does the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa speak? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaks every language that has ever been that we can consider to be spiritual in nature. You know, the nature of spiritual language, there's no phonemes, there's no sound. It's like angels in their true form. In their true form, they don't speak with sound, angels. They say the closest language to the language of the angels that we understand is what we call telepathy. They are like telepathic in nature. They communicate but without sound. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam communicated to angels on behalf of God without sound. That's the hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari. They asked him, Kayfa, how are you revealed unto? And the Prophet described varying forms of revelation. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke about one, Yafsu anni ruh, that my soul departs from me. Such that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam yukhatib al-malak. So that the Prophet begins to speak to the angel, وَهُ أَشَدَّ عَلَيْهِ, and there is most difficult upon me. If you were gazing upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you'd see him go into a state of convulsions. It's like the nearest we've got is what we call an out-of-body phenomena. He'd go into convulsions sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the literal way, which is our topic tonight, he would wrestle with himself. Wrestle with himself. Such that the companions radiallahu anhu wa ta'ala would take off their armor. They would take off their scarves and they would just throw it over the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hakada. Throw it over the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Until the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had finished wrestling with himself. That's his khitab to the angels. That's his word to the angels. That is communicate with the angels. But it's not just angels that he sent to. He's also sent to the jinn in and of itself. Like the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the hadith of Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. When the Prophet addresses the companions, who would like to go with me on a journey today? Companions remain silent. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud says, Ana ya Rasulullah, I will, O Messenger of Allah. So the Prophet says, Qum, arise, follow me. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud says that he leaves with the Prophet beyond the valley and they head into the desert until the Rasul with his staff, and that staff would ordinarily be carried by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Ibn Umar. Until they arrive at the place in the midst of the desert, and the Prophet takes the staff and he draws a line in the sand. He says, Qum, sit. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud sits. And the Prophet says, no matter what you see, don't stand. No matter what you see, don't stand. So the Prophet continues to walk. Until the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet sits down in the midst of the desert, and thereby Abdullah ibn Mas'ud says, these creatures begin to appear from nowhere. And then this word, Kirijal Zut. They were like Rijal Zut. Rijal Zut, yani, it's like many a wrestler. You see, big, imposing bodies, smaller, disproportional heads. That's what Rijal Zut means. And these Rijal Zut begin to surround the Prophet. One by one, they're coming down to the will of the unseen. Kirijal Zut. Until Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, remember these huge towering figures. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu wa is like this high off the table, off the ground. He's small. He measured off the ground. He's saying, Dhira' wa Shaykh. That's his height. He's small, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. But these are Hamadun people who are in the company of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hearts like steel, brave hearts. They have. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud says, I go to stand in order to, yani, because he thinks the Rasul's been a gospel. And he said, I see the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, look at me and do this. Remain where I told you to remain. And he says, these beings swarm around the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet was no longer visible. Then I hear the Rasul begin to recite the Quran. The Quran. And then these beings begin to swarm around the Rasul until they all sit attentively in the majlis of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is communicating the jinn. That was the jinn coming down to the world of the unseen to sit with the Prophet ﷺ with adab, sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. But you know the nature of engaging the jinn. Nature of engaging the jinn. What's the word they use for those who engage the jinn? Musara, to wrestle with the jinn. That's how you engage with the jinn. Musara. But the jinn are going to learn one thing about the communication with the Prophet ﷺ. Nobody. Nobody whatsoever wrestles with the Prophet ﷺ. So he sent to the jinn, but he's also sent to the human beings. And the human beings are of different kinds and different types. If you want to bring our discussion, conversation here to a radical conclusion, we'll look at the type of people the Rasul ﷺ was sent to. It says that the Rasul ﷺ كان يخاطب كل قوم بلغته, that he would speak to every people in their language. In their language. Then what language is it that you speak? You see, often that we see language, we perceive language, is this manipulation of sound that allows us to bequeath meaning to those unto whom we're trying to communicate. That sound. And those ancient people who surrounded the Prophet ﷺ, they were the greatest manipulators of sound that the world has ever seen. That is not open to question. If you engage the language of the Arabic language, you will see those people took language to a point that people have not even seen. Never mind experience. The nature of those people who were a linguistic creature. That is why they're man, they're true man. Because when we define the human being as hayawanatik, as the speaking animal, then the greatest human beings are those who are the best in speech. And that's why Sayyidina Ali ibn Abi Talib, Sayyidina Ibn Abi Hala, they would always describe the Rasul as the best in speech. That's why they describe him as afsah, man antaqa bil-dad. He is the most eloquent to ever utter dad. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, dad, lughat al-Arab, the language of the Arabs. Because if they're the greatest in speech, then the one who's the greatest in that language is the greatest ala al-itlaq. Period, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But our point is, language is not just the manipulation of sound. There is a language that goes with your spirit. A man is a spiritual creature. There is a language that goes with your mind. And there is an intellectual man language. A man is an intellectual and rational being. But also there is a physical language. A man is a physical language. And so you will see the Prophet ﷺ often, he will speak a spiritual language to spiritual being. Sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. You see, we often speak intellectual language to intellectual beings, but our conversation is that the Arabs themselves, they were very physical beings. I mean, physical beings, people of power, people of steel. And they knew what we would call now the art of war. And the art of war is of two types. Two types. You see, this is sort of a conversation, two types. This is the conversation of the martial arts. If we were to look at the martial arts of the Prophet ﷺ, only two types. There's no fear. The first type, it relates to the manipulation of the human form. How you manipulate the human form. The manipulation of the human form in order to restrain an aggressor. Simply, it's about restraint. In the process of restraining an aggressor, that there cannot be any harm whatsoever that is done to that aggressor. You see, Allah Ta'ala, لا يحب المسرفين. Allah Ta'ala, لا يحب المعتدين. Allah Ta'ala does not love aggressors, people who go beyond the defined limit. Does it? So in that sense, the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who sent with the language of the body to a people who are very physical, the Prophet is going to tame them through the art of how you bring people to God, because that's the purpose. Bring them to God through praise of God, through the form, that the Prophet is going to teach them how to manipulate your form in order to restrain an aggressor. So what does that mean? One part of the martial arts of the Prophet is no striking whatsoever. No striking whatsoever. The Rasul does not advocate striking with the hand. The Rasul does not advocate striking with the legs. The Rasul does not advocate striking with the knees. Does not advocate striking with the elbows. Does not advocate striking with the hands. Not really. Sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Simply, how do you restrain an aggressor? That is in one art form, wrestling. That's all he has. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wrestling. And that's all those warriors have, wrestling. That's all they have. The other, which is not our conversation, is if there has to be harm, then the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has one principle. You send somebody to the grave, that's it. If you're going to harm a person, it's not to inflict harm, it's to save a life. So the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in that other aspect of his martial arts, the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is the bar. And bowing is to take life. The Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is a swordsman, carrying a sword. He's described in the Torah as the one who carries his sword around his neck. The Sahaba in the Torah are described as those who carry their swords upon their back. Very different. The only of the martial arts that we say still exists that carries their sword upon the back is ninjutsu, the ninjas. They carry swords upon the back. The rest of them carry their swords to the left side, swordsmen. But the nature of those hairy people, swordsmen. But swordsmanship is about severing life. The Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, short staff. He has the short staff, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, what you call the harba. The harba is about severing life of somebody who's proximate to you. The Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has what we'd call in maybe the Chinese arts, you'd call the long staff. He has the long staff sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from his martial arts. The long staff likewise, it's about severing life. About severing life from somebody who's at a distance to you. Like you see in the example of Mu'tah, of Sayyidina Hum, Sayyidina Ja'far and Abi Talib, radiallahu anhu wa radha, when the Romans came with the long staff to Sayyidina Ja'far, they don't want to attack Ja'far. Proximate, close. Beware of coming close to those people trained in the madrasa of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they stabbed Sayyidina Ja'far from a distance. From a distance, with a long staff. What does Sayyidina Ja'far do? He brings the long staff right through his body. Right through his body with his sword, and he severs the head of the one who stabbed him. That's Sayyidina Ja'far. That's martial arts. It's about severing life. Radiallahu anhu wa ta'ala. Our conversation, don't worry, we're not about severing life here. I know that his life will be severed by these dear people. They're of the first kind of martial arts advocated by the Prophet ﷺ, which is no harm. It's about the restraining, effective restraint of an aggressor. The Rasul ﷺ, he told us, don't throw stones, don't throw missiles at people. He said, the best it can do is it can take out an eye. He says, if you fight second time, you fight to kill. That's what he said to Ali. That's not our conversation, okay? We fight to restrain. We fight to restrain. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because he has to convince people who are very physical, they're very physical in nature. I mean, the Arabs, some of us who sit, we see some of the students who sat and studied the science of Sarah, or studied the science of Sarah, the Arabs, they were wild, yeah. And they were brilliantly wild. Brilliantly well, such that the willpower, the superpowers of the world would not dare enter into Arabia. The might of Rome, you know, we lay in our history of this island, the old roads lead to Rome, except the roads in Arabia. And the roads in Arabia don't lead to Rome, because the Romans don't enter into Arabia. The might of the Holy Roman Empire, but they don't conquer Arabia, don't conquer it. The Arabs are too wild and too brilliant in their wildness. The might of Persia, Persian Empire that brought the Roman Empire crashing to its knees before the rise, once again after the fall of Rome. That empire, they don't go into Arabia because the Arabs are wild and they're brilliant in their wildness, in their wahshiya, in their jahiliya, brilliant. You know, the days of the Arabs before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they call the days of the Arabs, they call Ayyam al-Arab. It's a literature, a body of literature. If you study Ayyam al-Arab, it's all one thing. What is that? War. It's all the art of war. Like if you read one of the great poems of Arabia, the poem of Antara, you read Antara's poem, it's all about the art of war, the art of steel. That's the history of the Arabs themselves. And they were brilliant in it. And not just brilliant in what we spoke about the second type, which are extended arm techniques, they're brilliant in the form, the manipulation of form. Think about it. Now these are brilliant wrestlers. You've seen them, they're brilliant wrestlers. But if you want to speak of the Arabs, let's speak about the brilliant wrestler. Let's speak about Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib. Hamza, brilliant. Probably the greatest martial artist the world's ever seen, with the exception of the Prophet Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib. Where did he take the art of wrestling to? In Arabia, in the Arabic language, you have over 300 words for the lion. Because ancient Arabia was populated, densely populated by lions. Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib would go to the jungle, wrestle lions. That's his training. Wrestling lions. Think about it. You wrestling a lion. You're going to restrain a predatory beast. The greatest of all of the predatory beasts. That has one objective: to take life. And you're not about taking its life. You're not about taming it. Restraining it. To prove your prowess. Your ability to manipulate form. That's Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib. Radiallahu anhu wa anhu. An imam of Jahiliyyah. Hamza. Radiallahu anhu wa anhu. Now, the season which we're in Jahiliyyah, Hajj, this season was about wrestling, of the things it was about, at Iqab. You know, with the Muna, some of our brothers coming back from it, isn't it? From the brothers from Bradford. At Muna, you would gather at Muna to wrestle. You see, who were the greatest wrestlers inside Arabia? If you were at Muna, you would see Hamza. If you were at Muna, you'd see Abbas. If you were at Muna, you'd see Umar ibn Khattab, supreme wrestler. Umar ibn Khattab would enter the competition at Iqab. If you were at Muna, you would see Khalid ibn Walid, radiallahu anhu warda, train, like Aladdin trained these, this is Aladdin, he trained these two wrestlers to your side, Ismail and Mateen. Umar ibn Khattab trained Khalid ibn Walid, reared him in the art of wrestling, till he could enter into the competition at Iqab. You see, the last time Umar wrestled with Khalid, Khalid pinned Umar. And when Khalid pinned Umar, first time, pinned Umar, it was the first and last time. Umar ibn Khattab wore, he never wrestled again. Why? Because now you can wrestle. When you can pin me, now you've come of age. And then Khalid radiallahu anhu warda, Ibn Walid, is studying in West Point. West Point, the Supreme Military Academy of America, that Khalid Walid studied right there. Radiallahu ta'ala anhu warda. These are men from the madrasa of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But our point is, and the point is real. When you look at these types of people, radiallahu anhu warda, like look at Hamza. No, for Hamza, for faith to enter into the heart of Hamza ibn Abu Talib, the Prophet must touch Hamza. Because Hamza, it's a physical language. And the form has its own intellect, its own mind. Hamza must be touched. Not everybody's touched. But physical, we must be touched. For Umar ibn Khattab in Dar al-Arqam, when he enters Dar al-Arqam, who's there, Hamza? Who is it, Umar? They said. Sayyidina Hamza, who's there in the house of the Prophet said, if he's come with peace, then it's all good, it's all peace. But if he's come with war, I will kill him with his own sword. Now how are you going to do that? You're going to kill a man with his own sword. What does that mean, what Hamza said? And so when Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab enters, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wrestles Umar. That's his first move, he jumps onto his feet, takes hold of Umar ibn Khattab, locks Umar ibn Khattab, is in a time before punishment descends from the heavens. Umar understands the land of physics. Khalid Walid even more has to go in battle against the Rasul. He has to reach scenario number two, where it's do or die with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But he survives the encounter. Only thereby for the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to say to Khalid, I knew you would come to your senses, your physical senses. That's Khalid Walid. You study him, he's a very, very physical person. His intelligence is in his form. They say about Khalid Walid, he couldn't even finish an entire surah of the Quran. Khalid Walid. That's not the type of being he was. But physically, it's like he had no parallel. Radiallahu ta'ala anhu wa ta'ala. That's the Rasul going to Khalid Walid, going to Umar ibn Khattab, going to Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib. Then you hear the others, like Bukhari ibn Abi Yazid, supreme wrestler in multiple, too many traditions of Bukhari ibn Abi Yazid, of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wrestling Sayyidina Rukana in the great valley, immortalized by Busaydi, Idom, that valley of Idom, that the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would meet Rukana at Idom and they would wrestle. First, the Rasul wants to speak his language. His language is wrestling, but you wrestle why? Dunya. It's for fame, prominence inside of the world. So we'll fight over dunya. That's the Rasul. What is it? He said a wager, one sheep. So the Rasul goes against a man who's never wrestled in his entire life. Now here's the point, never wrestle. The Prophet Rukana goes against a man, the Rasul who's never wrestled in his entire life. Now I want some of you tonight to feel that meaning. And raise your hands if you've never wrestled. Raise your hand. You've never wrestled in your entire life. Ever. So you see, I can point at you, I can point at you, I can point at you, I can point at you. You come on the mat. And you wrestle people who've been wrestling for 33 years, for 20 years, 22 years. Some who've been wrestling, like at the end, who've been wrestling for 17 years. You wrestle them. And let's see how far you get. Now here's the Rasul going against a man who only knows his wrestling. His father's a wrestler, uncle's a wrestler, grandfather's a wrestler. You know, the races, those families of wrestling families, of jiu-jitsu practitioners, goes against first time. Rasul pins him. I mean, without a conversation. There's not a conversation. No. We have our dear esteemed teacher, Mr. Amjad there, Sifu Amjad Ali there, and he always tells us about Wing Chun, that it's a conversation. Is that what you say, Amjad? It's a conversation. That's what he says in Wing Chun, it's a conversation. So the Rasul has a conversation with Rukana, but Rukana utters no words. It's like he takes hold of him and pins him. And we go again, second time. Another sheep, no conversation, pin the second time. Third time, no conversation, pin the third time. In the hadith, Rukana kana maghmuma, his face tense. He's sad. Mabika, what's wrong with you? He said, these are my dad's sheep. And my dad's a wrestler too. If I don't bring those sheep back home to pops, then I may be getting wrestled by pops. So the Rasul Sa'isan, take your sheep. You know, sheep in the Arabic language, man, it's the same word for money. I ain't about money. Take the sheep. They come back again. Second occasion. It's still dunya. You ain't got the point yet. What is it now? Ten sheep. Rasul goes against him, 10 sheep. Pins him. No conversation. We go again, 10. Pins him. No conversation. 20. Go against him again, 10. 30 sheep. Pins him. No conversation. I mean, say some words, some physical words. He has no words with the Prophet whatsoever. He's getting the point. When they go the final time with the Rasul, now the Rasul has words for him. If I pin you, and I will pin you. But if I pin you, you believe in me as the messenger of God. Now that's the conversation. So he's been sent to Rukana with a physical language. If you're going to start saying La ilaha illallah, in we show him mu'ajizat, Rukana is not going to believe. In the tradition, the Rasul tells Rukana, Rukana says, prove to you the messenger of God. The Prophet tells Rukana, see that tree? That tree over there, go and call the tree. Tell the tree Muhammad wants the tree. Rukana goes over the tree and says to a tree, which one of us will go and speak to a tree? Like I told you, get up, see that door? Go over to the door that's got Zainab Hafsa upon it. Go to that door and tell the door Ibrahim wants the door. Go. You're going to think, my man's a bit doolal, yeah? That's what you're going to think. You ain't going to respond. Rukana responds. He goes to the tree and says, Muhammad wants you. And the tree in the tradition uproots itself and it begins to drag its roots along the desert sand to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, Men ana, who am I? And the tree says, speaks yantiq, a language, manipulation of sound, anta Rasulullah, you're the messenger of God. But this is the point. Rukana, when he sees that, he don't believe. Because that is not his language. His language is not the language of miracles. His language is wrestling. And so the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam wrestles Rukana. One time, two times, three times, over faith. Now Rukana is going to enter into the world of faith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. That's his language. And you'll see so many times with the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and he one by one, seeking out, not being sought, seeking out the greatest wrestlers in Arabia, like Jumahi, Abu Aswad al-Jumahi, supreme wrestler, who you cannot shift his feet. This one still bewilders me. You know, the day we were sort of wrestling, standing wrestling with our Sifu, we were wrestling, and so every time we come together, he pushes the faqir. And he said the very thing which stuck in my mind, he just said, lower your center. Lower your center, lower the center. And so when I began to lower my center, then he couldn't shift me. Lower your center. So I'm trying to figure out how in the tradition that Abu Aswad al-Jumahi, he could stand upon leather. And then 8 Arabians, Arabic, when you hear them described, they are like really, they're like 7 foot in height. Umar ibn al-Khattab was 9 foot in height. No fat content, athletic. He could hold his foot, jump through his arms onto a horse. He forbade his people from mounting a horse with stirrups. He said, lest you become lazy and non-athletic. They had to do somersaults. You see them do somersaults. They had to do somersaults onto horses. They were at 9 foot in height. You that athletic. That's Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. That's the Arabian. So they would take the leather upon which Jumahi was upon, and they would try just to move and shift his feet, and they couldn't. I'd say, let's challenge any martial artist to pull off that one. Where you could stand upon leather, one man would shift your foot. One man would be able to shift you. Never mind 8 men of physical strength, they said the leather would shred beneath his feet. Until he stood against the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. There wasn't even a conversation. This is our conversation, huh? We have to learn to wrestle with the angels. We even have to learn to wrestle with devils. The hadith of Umar ibn Khattab. Umar ibn Khattab wrestled the devil. The devil. Not a devil, the devil. Wrestled and pinned the devil. The hadith of Ammar ibn Yasar, when he goes to get water, the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells Ammar, on your way you're going to confront a man. You're going to confront a man. And that man's going to prevent you from water. And that man's a demon. Ammar ibn Yasar radiallahu anhu warda, found the man, wrestled the man, pinned the man, took his water. Say Na'amah. Wrestled. The companions used to wrestle in the road of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That space that we wrestle to get into, they wrestled in the midst of. That's how important wrestling is in this tradition. Look at the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, right there in the blessed house of the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and beyond the side of the Rawdah, the hadith in Ibn Asakir of Sayyidina Hassan and Hussein wrestling, Sayyidina Shababu Jannah, wrestling together. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is like, E Hassan, like, go Hassan, go Hassan, go Hassan. Rasul khalas, cheer for Hassan. Sayyidina Fatima Zahra radha'anha wardaha, she says, Ya Rasulullah, ka'anna al-Hassan ahabba ilayhi. It's as if Hassan is more beloved to you. You're cheering for Hassan in this wrestling match. And the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa says, La, not necessarily, but there's Gabriel shouting, E Hussein, go Hussein, go Hussein, go Hussein. Look at Gabriel descending from where? To cheer on Hussein. The Rasul, Supreme Spirit, descending from where? To cheer Hassan. But look at the pastime of angels. Look at the pastime of prophets. And look at the pastime of whom? Sayyidina Shababu Jannah. We ask Allah Ta'ala for tawfiq, because by Allah, this is a very serious conversation. Okay? This is not how we just pass time. But this is more so how we manipulate time in order to approach Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala in praise. We ask Allah Ta'ala for tawfiq.